Hey everybody, I hope there are some folks here. I am running solo this evening. Adele will be joining in a little bit, well, shortly. She's en route, and our guest should be here shortly as well. So wanted to thank everybody who's been following us, all the questions and comments of folks. Okay, continue recording. I hope everyone hearing me. Okay. Okay, everybody's joining. This is going to be wild. Can anybody hear me? Do you folks hear me out there? Yes, no? Can you hear me? Omri, ta shomeoti? Yofi.
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, great. So thank you.
I can hear you too.
Okay, Adele is there and
I am here.
But drive careful.
I will.
Okay, and let's see, we've got more folks coming in. Looks like we're gonna have a big house. And everybody who's here, tell your friends, tell your relatives, tell the folks down the street from you, come join the show. We've got some interesting stuff here that affects real life stuff you're not gonna see in the media anywhere, pretty much. And I follow the media pretty closely. So without going into updates of what's been going on, you've been following on the page. It's been a horrifically dark and dismal and very painful day for the whole House of Israel. And I myself, as I said to a friend offline, Valerie, that I'm feeling personally battered emotionally and psychologically. I think most of us are. In any case, we are going to move on because life here does move on and we don't give in to despair and to the grief. So with no further ado, I'd like to introduce Omri Lerner of Kumu. He's a resident, a dad, family man from the Moshav Kahal, which is just overlooking a gorgeous overlook of the Sea of Galilee between there and Safed in northern Israel. Now, Omri, tell us a little bit about yourself and Kumu, and let's go forward with the school from there.
Okay, thank you. My name is Omri. I'm married. I have three daughters, one in elementary school, one in middle school, and one in high school. We live in Kahal. Kahal is a very quiet, small community. Basically, we are at the southern edge of the Mevot Hermon Regional Council, which means that our
You're frozen. Okay. Nitkata, Omri.
Now we're at the southern edge, which means about 20-21 miles from the Lebanese border. Basically, it's a quiet place even now. We have air raid sirens about once every 10 to 15 days. Nothing really happens too much. We're far enough not to feel the war intensively on a daily basis. But you go 2 or 3 miles to the north of us, that's where the war zone starts. And for our purpose, that's where most of our services, community, schools, businesses, that's where they are. So the center of our lives, though we live outside the war zone, the center of our lives are in the war zone. And it's quite a tough thing to bear. On a personal level, Dave, you shared your feelings. And I'll talk in the next sentences about Kumu, but one of my friends from Kumu is Or Gat, whose sister is Carmel Gat, that was murdered a few days ago and found yesterday. Just this afternoon, about 3 hours ago, Kfar Yuval, which is one of the villages in our council on the border, there was a direct hit on a house and three men were injured, one of them severely. All three have daughters or sons in my girls' classes. So the fathers of my daughter's classmates. So not being in the border, but being inside it very intensively is the kind of way we live right now. Just a few words about Kumu. It's not the main thing here. Kumu is an organization that comes from the edges, from the Western Negev, from the northern border. Basically, it's people that are saying, hey, if we don't rise up and do something to change the way our lives are, there's no reason they're going to change. And it's not just about the war. It's a result of what happened at the beginning of the war, feeling that there's nobody to back us up. But when you look at it in a broader perspective, you find these areas for tens of years are not in the main focus of the Israeli society. And we have a lot of difficulties because of it. One of them just now that I can share with you, it took me about 10 minutes to connect to the internet right now. Because in these areas of Israel, the internet is not as good as in the center of the country. Yeah. So basically, the idea is that if we don't do something, then after the war, we're going to stay behind even more than before the war. And the idea is to rise up and start doing things about it. Part of it is making sure that we get better education, making sure that a broader range of businesses come back to the war zones after the war is over. And part of it is demanding from our local leaders to take responsibility for this change. Responsibility is a big word that is quite missing in Israel right now.
Accountability. Accountability.
I'm not talking about accountability because that's in Israel. That's now a political phrase. I'm saying responsibility. You have a job. You're responsible to do it as best as you can. We're not going to let you slack anymore. That's the idea.
If I can just point out to the viewers, some of the folks who aren't around, and also, so you should know, Adele Raymer, she's the founder of this page, this webpage. She's been a resident of Nirim along the Gaza Strip for the last, 40 plus years? Right, shaking her head, yes. And for those of you who are watching, you should know that gated communities like where I live in Kfar Hanania and where Omri lives in Kahal aren't strong gated communities like you might think in America or the UK, perhaps. They're very weak internally, and so much of the decision-making is at the regional council level, to whether they take out garbage or not, to the infrastructure, how much you're paying for what do you call it, the infrastructure payments. We call it Arnon, I can't think of the word in English now.
Municipality bill.
Thank you. Thank you. So for a lot of people, like, he doesn't have good internet. It may be because of that. If we don't have good garbage collection, or we have a bomb shelter that was brought and then taken away because we don't have the tools administratively to run our community as well as you might suppose abroad. Just a difference from here as composed to kibbutz in the south or in the north. And Kfar Yuval is an example of that. There are kibbutzim all along the northern border that are shell-shocked literally. And let's see if we have some other folks to bring into the conversation. But I'm gonna let you go ahead and tell us a little bit about getting ready for school. What does it mean to send your daughters to school in a frickin' war zone?
So first of all, there are a lot one of the things you learn quite fast is that there are a lot of different shades of war zone, okay? Basically, each one of my three daughters is in a different situation right now. The young one is starting third grade right now. Her school is a primary school that's not so far from us. It's in what is considered quite a safe area. And when I say quite a safe area, it means that about once a week they get bombed. So they have to stop in the middle of school, go into the shelters, wait 10 minutes, and then go out. And usually that's the end of the day. It doesn't matter what time it comes in the day, because you small children, after an air raid siren, it doesn't matter if they hear even explosions or not. The siren itself is for them emotionally the end of the day. So about once a week, I have to. Yeah, but this is the most the southernmost primary school in the region. All of the others are in areas where firing is a daily thing on the routes to the schools, on the schools themselves. So basically, I'm in a privileged condition where I don't have to make the a consideration between the value of education and the value of safety. But most of the parents, that's the consideration they have to take every morning if they decide to send their children or not. Yesterday, we were very glad that all the schools are going to open. We weren't sure it was going to happen. And this morning, about half of the children in the region, their parents did not send them to school because of safety concerns. So basically, we're having a system where the parents have to take responsibility, personal responsibility, to decide between safety and education. That's in the primary schools. When you go up a level to middle schools and high schools in our region are the same organizations. It's not different schools. And the big regional school is in Kfar Blum. Kfar Blum is inside the war zone. And right now it's not safe for more than 200 kids to learn there. They learn inside the bomb shelters in the school. They don't learn in their regular classes. But there are 1,200 students in the school. So we had to figure out what to do with the rest of the 1,000 kids. And what happened over the past 5-6 months is that we built an alternative campus for the school, a provisional one, basically bringing in homes on trucks and classes on trucks with bomb shelters right next to them. But since it's a process that takes a few months, the numbers we thought about a few months ago are not what's going on right now, because a few months ago, a lot more of the people that were evacuated were spread in all different kinds of places in Israel. During the summer, most of them came back to this region. They didn't go back to their houses, but they're renting places as close as they can to their houses. So if we thought we have to build a solution for about 650 to 700 pupils, we're now looking at 900 to 950 pupils that are coming today. So basically not enough classes yet. It's going to take a few months to build more classes. And then on top of that, one of the things that's happening right here is that we lost last year. Last year, my girls studied about between 3 and 4 times a week for 3 hours. That's what they had because we didn't have schools. We couldn't go to the regular schools, so they learned afternoon or evening in a different school after it was finished. So now basically we're 1 year behind, and we're starting this year with not enough classes, not enough teachers. So we're probably not gonna get more behind this year. So
question. Question: is the government funding these efforts?
Yeah. Well, the government mostly is funding these efforts. I have to say that it takes a lot of struggle from parents, from school boards, from school managements to get this funding. But at the end, after a fight, we get it. One of the things that you have to understand that we're living right now in a very different economy than what it was a year ago. So basically the funding is not abundant, and we have to fight over everything we can. It's a political struggle. We found ourselves going to the Knesset a lot. Maybe I was there maybe 20 times this year in order to procure the funds needed for this school, for the schools in safer areas. And at the end, we get the funding we need, but it's a struggle.
Nothing's easy. Nothing's simple.
Yeah, nothing is simple. It is. But after I said that today, the feeling of accomplishment in this area of the people, that the school's opened, for us, it's a big accomplishment because we didn't thought it was possible just 3 months ago. So on the side of the struggles and the tough situation, there are a lot of strengths in the people, in the community, in the parents, in the schools, in the kids that are getting a lot of expression right now, because you have to fight for what you need, and you find out that when you fight, you get what you need, and it empowers you. So I'm not so sure it's just a bad situation. It has a lot of good things inside it that we need to seize, and maybe take with us when we go forward to the future.
Do you feel? You say you're empowered. Do you feel any closer with other parents groups from other communities? Because you're behind a hill off a highway, on the other side of a highway, from a lot of other places. I love your place because you got beehives out there. We're beekeepers. And I just love to sit there and watch the Sea of Galilee from the beehives. But that's one question. My other question is, how are psychologically your children coping with it? I mean, their year has been punctuated, literally punctuated, with rockets and bombs, schools on, schools off. I can tell you on the WhatsApp groups for the local councils, they'll send notices, official notices, that will be, sorry. Okay, that's gonna have to wait. All right, sorry about that.
Okay, until he comes back, I'll start with the first question.
Well, sorry about that.
I started to answer your questions.
Yeah.
Basically, the war has brought us together a lot more than we were before. Mainly from two perspectives. One, we found out that working regionally, everybody together gets more things done than each community for itself. And it's something that we're working together to get things done. We're working all of the school parents boards together, and all of the main people that are from the civil society that are in jobs that have something to do with services. We start working together. And from that perspective, it's a good thing. One of the things that you have to understand about that is this area was basically torn apart with a few social feuds, historical social feuds between Kiryat Shmona and the kibbutzes around it, between the Mushavim and the kibbutzim, and it's all wiped away right now. We help each other. We work together for common solutions to a lot of things. I can tell you something from this week. We're working now with Machon Weizmann, which is one of the
Weizmann Institute in Rehovot.
Science
Institute.
Yeah, it's one of the top tier institutes in science world. In the world. Yeah, and we're bringing a branch of it to our area. We're working on it, Kiryat Shmona and the kibbutzim and the moshavim together. We're going to have a provisional one for the next year, and then a permanent one, hopefully, in Kiryat Shmona.
That's a big deal.
It is. It's a game changer for this for the kids in this area. So that's one thing you have to understand. The other thing is there is a rift between those who were evacuated and those who were not, because those who were evacuated have a whole system of support from the government that they receive. And I have no, from my perspective, it's good that they have it, but all the ones that weren't evacuated don't have this kind of support system. So basically a lot more economic problems, a lot more educational problems, a lot more health issues, a lot of things that it's inside our communities. So some of my best friends are evacuees right now, and their children get better schools than my girls right now, though they were in the same school just a year ago. So it's a struggle to keep the ties together and not create a rift on this perspective.
May I ask a question about that? Okay, because you mentioned earlier, and I just want to give a very, very canned response about the kibbutzim and Kiryat Shmona. This is going back to the 50s and 60s, where you'd have predominantly North African Jews in Kiryat Shmona and the Moshavim, and then you would have Ashkenazi kibbutz members, and there was always a social divide there between the first and second Israel, if you follow my logic. You're saying that's been wiped out largely because everyone's together now in battle under rocket fire. Well, but it's starting again with the kids.
It's from a demographic perspective, it's been wiped out for the past 40 years. Do you see Ashkenazis and Sephardic Jews everywhere? It doesn't matter.
I'm
you
talking about 50s and 60s, everywhere. Not now. It's 2024.
It's since the 1980s, 1990s. It was a big change in this perspective, but it didn't change the narrative, the story that we told ourselves about the region.
That's
starting to change right now.
And the phrase is in Hebrew, Medinat Gadera Hadera, the state that exists, the Israel that matters, is from Hadera on the coast down to Gadera, another city near east, inland from Ashkelon mostly. In other words, a very small area, and the periphery is what's called in Hebrew, the peripheria, was always getting the little bits off the edge of the table, whether it was in the south and the kibbutzim, or whether it was in the north in Kiryat Shmona. Everyone's always begging from the centralized government to get more funding. And that's very roughly how it's existed to date. And so this, you're saying this may change at this point.
It is. We're starting, well, part of it is even deliberate. We're starting to build a new story about who we are here in this area. And the story is that we're struggling together, not against each other. And it's a new story, and it's a potential for a new story that has a lot of for me a lot of hope for this area. Mm-hmm. I'll come back to the second question you asked. Well, each one of my I'll answer it personally. Each one of my girls has a different effect psychologically. My eldest, she's going into 11th grade, and basically she found out last year that she doesn't need school, that if she comes or doesn't come to school, it's fine. She found a job, she's working, she's earning money, she's studying on her own on online platforms that she found. And for her, the main problem that has been happening since the war started is her friends. She hasn't met a lot of her friends on a daily basis as she used to. And one of the things that it made her more focused inward. She has less need for friends right now. She spends less time with them. A lot of it is online and less person to person on a personal level. And I think it's a long-term effect that we'll maybe see the prices to pay for it in the next years. With her social skills, that's my eldest
daughter.
That's
a big. That's a big thing.
It is.
Yes.
It is. My middle daughter.
My kids too.
She moved. She right now moved from seventh to eighth grade, but basically she started seventh grade, which in our area it's the beginning of a new school. So she said goodbye to all her friends from the primary school, and she didn't get to know anybody in her new school, and the war started. And then she learned in a different place with different people. And now she's starting to get back to a school where she has permanent classmates, but it's a year late. And her biggest struggle is basically getting out of the house and meeting people. Mm. She's afraid of people. She lost all her social confidence. So that's the main concern psychologically that we have with her. The little one, she's going to third grade. Basically, she has what we call an ongoing traumatic response. It's not a PTSD, okay? But every bang she hears, every ambulance she hears, every loud noise she hears, she stops, she freezes, she looks around. She asks herself what it is, if she needs to do something about it or not. It's a basic instinct that she adapted from basically to keep her safe. Yeah, it's a good thing on one level, but then again, she's afraid of a lot of things around her right now. And it's something that we know from the South that has happened over the past 20 years with children there. And they're more anxious, that they have more problems concentrating. Every little thing, every small little thing shakes them up, and they're less able to continue on. They have to stop to relax and then continue on. So we're starting to see that with our younger daughter. And what I have to say is that in the South, it took about 5 to 6 years to realize there's a problem and start treating it. Here, we know there's a problem from day one. And on a personal level, but also on a regional level, we have what we call a resilience center, Chosen, in Hebrew. And they're working with the children from day one in order to try to prevent long-term problems from this war. The biggest problem is that the war is taking a lot of time. We're not used to that here.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is in many ways deja vu, because during the first and second Lebanon wars, your region was totally traumatized. So actually there are people there who do have a lot of experience treating trauma, right?
Yeah.
Are they coming are they coming kicking back into effect?
Yeah. We have a lot of professionals that are basically started working from day one, thousands of them. A lot of them, and it's part of the adaptation we had from the Second Lebanese War. But one of the things we have, one of the biggest problems here is the time span. When you have a short war, even if it's violent, it ends, and you know it ends, and then you can recover from it. Right now, we're in a conflict that has no end the way we feel it. We don't see how it ends.
It's war of attrition.
In that perspective,
it hasn't even started.
And in some ways, yeah, in the north, it hasn't even started. And the thing is that you can't start recovering from anything that hasn't finished. So it's very different from the past wars we had.
I just would think our enemies, our foes, are using that as a tool, as leverage to bleed us white. And some say our allies are doing that as well to get more favorable terms for a bigger geopolitical picture. What are you doing with yourself now? Are you working full time with Kumu, with this organization? Are you?
No, I'll
took a glance at your LinkedIn, but I'd like to hear more.
Well, I'm an entrepreneur. I have a few businesses I built up, and one of them I'm still working with it, but two of them were from. They were placed in Snir, which is a kibbutz on the border, and it was evacuated, so I had to close them down. One of my areas of study, I'm a social worker, community social worker. So as the war started, I had to close my businesses. I had a lot of free time. So I called our resilience center, the local one. I said, look, I can help. Tell me what to do. And basically, for the past 10 months, I've been working with the evacuees in the hotels, helping them build back up their communities, which is a tough struggle for most of them. And then Kumu is on the side. It's not a job. It's something that I do as a volunteer.
Labor of love.
Yeah, a labor of love, a labor of necessity, I call it, not of love, but okay. So right now my income comes from my one business that's still open and from the resilience center where I work.
Okay. Anybody has any questions? People are watching very intently, but I'd really like for people to join in. So it's not just a dialogue here. You're not the studio audience. You're part of what's going on here. And we have a lot of very warm and close interactions offline, and not so many here. So if anybody has any questions, Mark, what's your take on what he's saying here about families and kids when you get time to sleep?
it's it's very scary, and keeping your kids focused with red alerts about them all the time. I feel for your youngest who understands but doesn't understand. And this is a life she's growing up in. It's a horrible situation.
I agree with you. It is a horrible situation. But I'm going to say something that makes him sound a little weird for some of you. I don't think we have choice but to realize where we live in. This area we live in the Middle East, we're not going to get only fun and happiness and happy endings all the time. The region is a bubbling cauldron of violence in a lot of places. And we have to cope with it. And part of it is also growing up in this land where you have to cope with things. So I know that it looks horrible from the outside. From the inside, it doesn't look the same. It's a lot about finding the good things inside where you can and creating the strength to cope with the bad things as much as you can. And I think it strengthens, us. It's not just horrible. It is horrible, I agree, but it's not just horrible. As for the sleeping, look, I'm a bit hyperactive. I sleep anyway only 4 hours a day. I have been like that all my life, so I have enough sleep.
Going back to your earlier comment, working at the refugee center, in February, I had the opportunity to go to one. We met with Dave, and the people seemed content, and they were from Kiryat Shmona. But is there, I don't know if there's a right word, jealousy between those that are evacuated and those that aren't? I mean, we came over with toys, with, we went to a center, Dave would know the name of it, where we, a sorting center of all items, clothing, distributed.
Kibbutz Magal, Magen, it was on the Sea of Galilee.
Yeah.
Right.
Ruti so Moses. How is it?
Yeah, right. Ruti.
Yeah. So, first of all, there is jealousy on the sideline. Okay, it's not the main feeling that you get, but it happens. Basically, every time you hear someone get jealous, about 1 minute later, you find out that they're not willing to change places with anybody. So, basically, I can't get jealous that other people are getting treated well, but they're. Then after a while, I see that I am not willing to change places with them. So probably what they're getting is rightfully like that. And maybe I need something more than I have, but it doesn't have to be about them. It's about what I need. And you get these dialogues and monologues inside yourself and then with your friends and with your community. And I think that as you go over time, we more and more understand that everybody's in a bad place right now.
Okay, we have two questions coming up, and then I want to make my own commentary here about an event that happened here over Shabbat in the last few days. Very relevant to everything that Mark said and what Omri said. One question, how many people actually come back on the long scale, long term, or is the evacuation for some forever? And that's a very, very burning question right now in the Israeli politic. And yeah. Secondly, from Valerie, do you feel abandoned by the government?
Okay. Well, we don't know. We don't know how many people are going to come back. Any prediction about that is just that, a prediction. It does have
you
nothing.
You can say many people are moving closer.
Yeah, but,
in our village, there's a lot of people who are refugees who are living, renting up houses. Here in our village.
Yeah, but I think that the question will matter more when this thing is done and we see what this region looks like in the future, because people are not going to come back if it's going to stay behind all the rest of the country. So the question will be a lot tougher, maybe in a few months when the war in some way finishes or diminishes, and then we can start seeing to the future again. And I can tell you about my closest friends. Most of them will not come back if the region will not change a lot for the better compared to before the war. I'm not talking about during the war. So I think that the question will be relevant only as we go ahead. Here and now, it has no relevance right now. Nobody knows. And the other one about feeling abandoned, first of all, yes. Okay, it's not a political thing. I'm not even talking about the political level of our government. The professionals inside the ministries of the government, and everywhere you go, people sympathize with you, but don't do anything. You have to make them do things. And when you realize that that's a situation, it's also the same in the political level, but also on the professional level, you understand that nobody cares about you, and it's a feeling of abandonment. Yeah, definitely. I have to emphasize, it's not about my political views. It doesn't matter if I like this government or not. I think that they should care about me as a citizen. And that's not happening right now.
I can say that several of the groups that I'm involved in here in the North, 1701 and Otef Levanon and other groups, they're it's not left and right as maybe you're seeing in the foreign media. It simply isn't. There are people who are like holding their tongues as best as possible for their political, personal politics and saying, no, we have a mission, we have a need, a burning need to do better for this region. And it doesn't matter where you are on the political spectrum. And I've spoken to people and seen what they do and things behind the scenes. And what he's saying is so. I'd like to say one thing. You sound somewhat, Omri, I love your optimism, Bacha Meira. In this way, we'll win together. Amen. You somehow sound, Anja says, kind of optimistic. How do you keep on going? What makes you so resilient?
Thank you. I am optimistic. I'm always optimistic all my life. It's part of my character flaws. I think that I can see a lot of things that we were missing before, especially in the relationships between people and communities that were part of the problems before the war, and now they're totally changed. And in that manner, I think we have a lot of potential going forward. That's a big part of my optimism. The second thing is that we're on the side of the abandonment feeling. There's also an understanding in Israel that there will have to be a focus on this region going forward. And that's another source of my optimism. We're going to have 2, 3, 4 years of more focus of the whole of Israel to this this area, also to the Western Negev. And if we seize this point in time where this happens,
the momentum.
We can create a momentum that will bring us to better places. So a lot of my optimism comes from the people around me and the future. It's not the here and now that makes me optimistic.
Right. To follow up on that. So my next door neighbor, who I've mentioned a few times in the past, Sharon and his wife and three sons, two of whom are, one is just after the army and does full-time Elohim in infantry. He's, I think, an officer. The second one is in the north on the Golan, and I see them only occasionally now. The youngest son had his bar mitzvah at our village synagogue over Shabbat. And on Thursday, I had the merit. I said, did you get a photographer? He said, no, we forgot. So I said, well, you got one now. So I photographed the whole bar mitzvah and I'll post pictures to the site because it was such a study of Israeliut, of Israeliness and resilience together with pain. Sharon's brother, Avichai's uncle, was from Kfar Aza, and he was the head of security at Kfar Aza. He was cut down in a firefight.